Let the church say, amen.
Amen.
Let the church say, amen.
Amen.
I tell you, it is a blessing to be in the house of God on this morning. And I thank Him. I thank God because He has been so good to all of us.
Oh, yeah.
There are things that we experience in life, things that we are experiencing now that God is doing for us,
yes,
that we can't fully appreciate.
Yes.
Amen. I'm breathing.
Yes.
And I'm not in control of that process.
Amen.
My heart is pumping blood, and I don't have anything to do with that. The sun is shining. He brought the rain on yesterday, and the trees are a little bit green. So we say thank you. I appreciate the invitation to come to East Capitol Street Church of Christ and to say a word about our relationship with our Creator.
Yes.
If you have not named the name of Jesus Christ, you are living beneath your privilege.
Amen.
You in this moment, if you have not named the name of Christ, you are living less than what you were created to live. I want to thank my wife, and I'm going to ask her to stand up. She's so pretty. Amen. She's so pretty. Stand up. Appreciate her being able to travel with me. This is Tony Francine Gibbs. And we have three beautiful children, and it's just a blessing to have her with me as my life's companion. And to be able to share life with her is a blessing. I appreciate Brother Lester. I have not had the opportunity to meet him, but I know that he is a wonderful minister. I appreciate Andre Johnson for the invitation and making all of the arrangements, and the other brothers who lead this congregation and all of the members of this congregation and from sister congregations. We just appreciate your presence. What Andre didn't tell you is that my theme or my lesson is God as Father. That's a lot, isn't it? Isn't that a lot? God is our Father. You have an earthly Father. But if you've been baptized into Christ, God is your Father. And when you think about God as Father, I'm going to do my best to preach a lesson dealing with God as Father. It's easy to say that God is my Father. Always easy to say that. But I want you to know what Jesus says, who will be called the children of God. So I want you to turn your Bibles with me to Matthew, the 5th chapter. And we're going to look at verse number 9. And I appreciate those who have led songs and others who have prayed and participated in this service thus far. The Bible says, blessed are the what? Come on now, y'all gonna have to wake up this morning. Blessed are the what? Come on now, church. Blessed are the what? The peacemakers. Watch what he says. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be what? They shall be called the children of God. Like I told you, it's easy to say that God is my Father. But he says that his children He says that his children are what? His children have a certain character. Those who would be called children of God, the Bible says, or Jesus speaks this, he says that they are peacemakers. In other words, they got the ones that started up a whole lot of mess. Come on now. They aren't the ones who are stirring the pot. Let me tell you something. If you look at life, and I know that we have boiled life down to things, the houses that we live in, the cars that we drive, the shoes that we wear, the perfume and clothes that we wear. But life is about relationships. Hmm. And I'm telling you that we have too many broken relationships. We have men who are willing to create a baby. But they're not willing to take care of that baby. We have brothers and sisters who are raised in the same house who don't speak. Husbands and wives who won't sleep in the same bed. It's relationships. You can make all the money in the world, but at the end of the day, you can't appreciate it if your relationships are not where they ought to be. And that's why Jesus comes on the scene and he's talking to these people and he's trying to help them understand who he is and who God is and who they need to be. And so he's not talking about their shoes. Come on now. He's not talking about where they eat now at the church. He's talking about the character of his children.
Oh, yeah.
So he says what? He says, blessed are the what? Now, what does it mean? What does it mean? I know that's what y'all asking. What does it mean to be a peacemaker?
All right.
I'm going to show you what the Bible says. Drop down to verse 43. How much time do I have? Nah. Oh, okay. That's crazy. I've been preaching longer than the week. Amen. Verse 43. The Bible says what? Ye have heard. It said, do what? That thou shalt love thy neighbor and do what? And hate your enemy. But watch what he says. He says, but I say unto you, do what?
Love
your enemies. Oh, that's a mouthful, isn't it? See, we say that because we read it and we've been in the church all of our life. So we say, love your enemies. That's what Jesus said, right? But I want you to think about your enemies right now. Come on now. Verse 44. What is it? He says, bless them that curse you. Watch what else he says. He says, do good to them that hate you. You got some haters? Well, as good as y'all saying yesterday, you have some haters. I will tell you, you got some haters. You have haters. Then he says, what? And pray for them who despitefully use you and persecute you. Why does he say this? Why is Jesus saying, love the enemies? Why is he saying, bless them that curse you? Why is he saying that we should pray for them that are using us in a despiteful way? Hold on. Verse 45. That you may what? Come on now. That
the father, then that means that we are his what? We are his children. But he says that the children of God, that they what? That they love their enemies.
Now I want to focus on that last piece. The last piece is prayer.
Yes.
If you want to know God as your Father, pray. If you want to have an intimate relationship with God, pray for somebody other than yourself. If you really want to know what the character of God is and share with him what it means to be Christ-like, pray for your enemies.
Yes, sir.
What I want you to see is that praying for your enemies is almost like the Atkins diet. You can't eat all those vegetables on that Atkins diet. You got to eat what? You got to eat meat.
Amen.
And it's almost as if the hardest thing to digest is the most effective. Isn't that something that's counterintuitive? That you can eat all that meat and lose all that weight, but it's the same thing when you're trying to grow closer to Christ. When you're trying to develop your personhood and Christ-likeness, the hardest thing to digest is what you got to do. If you want to look good, you got to pray for your enemies. Three things. In the lesson today, y'all said three things. He said, you're just not getting to your points? I want you to close your eyes. Right now, close your eyes. I'm not going to steal your money. Amen. Your eyes still open, brother. And I want you to think about somebody who has hurt you. Keep your eyes closed. I want you to think about someone who did not believe in you. Someone that you let get in close to you and they took advantage of the relationship, the trust that you gave them. I want you to think about someone who maybe you're jealous of, someone that you have gossiped on or has gossiped on you, someone who is hating on you in this moment. Now, open your eyes. Open your eyes. Y'all see that person?
No.
Can you see that person? Here's what I want to challenge you to do. I want to challenge you this morning to pray the prayer of restoration. And I want you to seek restoration with that person. And I believe that you can do it. Next 30 days, I want you to pray the prayer that we're about to go over in this lesson. The first point, what prayer does, the prayer of restoration does, is it helps you to see God. It helps you to see God. The second thing it helps you to do is it helps you to see yourself. The third thing that it does is it helps you to become peace. When you think about seeing God, think about this person. Maybe it is a child that you have raised up and they won't even talk to you, they won't care for you. Maybe it is a church member that when you see them coming, you go the other way. Maybe it's a childhood friend or a parent or someone that you were close to. If that relationship is defined by hurt, resentment, anger, that's not God's will for the relationship. If you're married and there's a wall, an invisible wall, that is between you and your spouse, that's not God's will. You want to know what God's will is? He said it in in John 17 and verse number 20, you might turn over there, he says, neither pray I for these alone, but for them also which shall believe on me through their word, that they may all be one. As our Father, that they all may be one as you, Father, are in me, and I in thee, that they may be what? One in us.
Yes.
God's will for your home is that there be unity. His church is that there be unity.
Amen.
I'm telling you that the church is divided.
Amen.
I'm going to say that over here because y'all not listening to me. The church is divided.
Amen.
And I'm telling you that much of it is not about doctrine.
Amen.
Amen.
A lot of it has to do with personality.
Amen.
A lot of it has to do with people hating on other people.
Well.
Jealousy. Homes are divided. And I'm telling you that kids, I'm a prosecutor. And I try murders, ag assaults, robberies. And the young people that I have to put in prison come from broken families. And I'm telling you that if you want to keep your family together, we got to deal with some of these issues. Jesus said a house divided against itself, it cannot. It can't stand. Here's what prayer does. And I thought Andre was going to be up here. What's your name, brother? Brother Hill. Stand up if you will. Here's what prayer does. And we're talking about it helps us see God. Brother Hill and I, we've been friends for 2 days. Amen. And see, in our relationship, it's going to work better with Andre, but Andre's not in here. Amen. Waters and light. But Brother Hill has learned to know me over these 2 days. And you know, Brother Hill, he knows what he wants from me. Amen?
Amen.
In our relationship, this 2-day relationship, he knows what he wants from me. And I know what I want from Brother Hill. So when we have a problem, there's a disconnect. He knows what he wants from me, and I know what I want from him. But you know what prayer does? What prayer does is it brings God into the situation. And instead of him asking, what do I want from Shelton? And what does Shelton want from him? It asks the question, what does God want in a relationship?
Amen.
You can have a seat. Thank you for the deal. So what I'm saying is that the first thing that prayer does is it brings God's will into the relationship.
Yes.
The second thing that prayer does is that it brings God's power into the relationship. I'm going to say that one more time. It doesn't just bring his will into the relationship because y'all are together and God's will is in that thing. And what you can't work out between yourself, what is impossible with Brother Hill and myself, becomes possible once God is involved in it. What I'm trying to help you understand is that God is a God that is powerful. It's the things that I want to do that I cannot do without the help of God. I'm telling you, when I bring God into a situation, we hadn't talked in 10 years. The hurt and the anger, I feel it in my chest and I can't get rid of it. But I'm telling you that when you get God, some things that you cannot do by yourself.
Amen.
You got to get God involved.
tell you a story, which is a true story about George Washington Carver. The story goes that in the South, they had planted so much cotton that they depleted the nutrients of the soil. They couldn't plant cotton. They weren't getting the return from the seed like they used to. So the story goes that George Washington Carver, he told these farmers, he said, plant peanuts. And so they planted peanuts. You know what happened? The nutrients came back. And this man, he was hailed a genius. But after a while, they had peanuts. And a whole lot of peanuts. And they couldn't sell these peanuts. They couldn't feed their families on peanuts. And so this man who was a genius, now he looked at me, this, what am I doing with all these peanuts? And so George Washington Carver, it says that he went into his laboratory, got on his knees, and he prayed over the peanuts. And he said, God, I don't know what I'm going to do with this peanut. Everybody's upset with me. What am I going to do? He came out of his laboratory, put 300 uses for the peanut. He knew how to make dyes out of peanuts. He made paint. He made penicillin out of peanuts. Peanut butter and jelly sandwiches out of peanuts. Come on now. Peanut butter and jelly sandwiches out of peanuts. I'm telling you, if God can bless his relationship with a peanut, somebody ever asks you the relationship with your wife, aren't you much more than a peanut? What am I saying? I'm saying that it's impossible without God becomes possible with God. Somebody ought to say amen. Not only does it bring God into the relationship, his will into the relationship, but it also helps you see yourself. First, you see God. But you know when you pray about your relationship, the next thing you see yourself. Let me tell you something about a relationship. It involves two imperfect people. See, I know that Brother Hill, I feel like Brother Hill is wrong, and Brother Hill feels like I'm wrong, and I'm telling you that both of us are probably wrong. So there's one perfect entity, and that is God. And I'm telling you, there's something about prayer. When you get on your knees and you pray, God reveals some things that are within you. The light is not shine on Brother Hill. When I get on my knees, the light is shining on me. And see, when God turns that light off, he's focused on my heart. See, prayer is a safeguard. If you got anger in your heart, if you got some resentment in your heart, if you got some angst in your heart, I'm telling you that God says there's some stuff that you need to deal with. Let me put some light on that. Turn to Matthew 5 and 23. Watch what Jesus said. And do I have somebody who can help me read?
Therefore, if you bring thy gift to the altar, and there remembers thy brother at all against thee, leave thy gift before the altar and go thy way. First be reconciled to thy brother, and then come offer thy gift.
See, when you think about church, here's what he's saying. He said, I know you want to come and offer me praise. I know you came with that check to put into the offering, amen, walls and lights. He said, I know you want to give me praise. You got all dressed up, but he said there are more important things than praise. Before you put your gift
in the altar, what does he say? He says, find your brother, find your son, find your daughter, find your brother, find your sister, find your husband. And if you know that they have a problem with you, he says to you what? Call now. He says what? He says you need to do what? You need to fix it. Second. He's going to need to fix it what? Fix it what? Come on now, read it. It's in your Bible. This is an open book text. He says you need to what? You need to fix it when? First. Don't put the offering in the collection plate until you what? Until you fix the situation with your brother. Turn to Ephesians 4:26. And I'll be where you want me to be in a minute. Prayer exposes the cancer in your heart. I'm telling you that somebody said that prayer, that anger is like drinking poison.
And expecting the other person.
And expecting the other person to die.
Mm-hmm.
It's like you drink poison. I want Andre to die. And so I drink the poison and I expect it to affect him. Who does it affect? It affects who? It affects you. Have you ever noticed when you mad at somebody or when you angry with somebody that when you leave Brother Hill, that the anger doesn't stay with Brother Hill? I'm mad at Brother Hill this morning. When I get to work, I'm still mad. Brother Hill is going about his way. He's doing his thing. He's driving down the highway smiling and singing and giving praise to God, but the anger is still what? It's with me. Now my secretary has to hear about it. When I get home, my dog ain't done nothing to me. I'm kicking the dog. Why? Because the anger is what? It's in me. It's a cancer. And that's what prayer does. Prayer says you need to deal with who? You need to deal with you first. Watch what the Bible says in Ephesians 4:26.
Be angry.
He says, it's okay to be angry.
And sin not.
He said, but don't sin. Really?
Let not the sun go down upon your wrath.
He said, now look, you can be angry, but don't let the sun go down on your wrath. Watch what he says. Why?
Neither give place to the devil.
Because when you do that, you give Satan a foothold.
Amen.
I'm trying to stay with my wife, but I'm angry. The next day, if I don't reconcile, that anger is still where? It's still there. Instead of talking to my wife, what am I doing? I'm walking by. That wall is where? It's building. Do that long enough. Your kids start being affected. Your finances start being affected. Why? Because cancer does what? Cancer grows. It doesn't stay. It grows. I know some families that my family does not associate with, and I don't know where it started. All I know is my daddy don't talk to his daddy. So I don't talk to his daddy or his son.
Tell the truth.
It's a cancer. Verse 31.
Let all bitterness,
uh-huh,
and wrath,
uh-huh,
and anger,
uh-huh,
and clamor,
free,
and evil speaking be put away from you.
In other words, he said, get rid of all that mess.
And be kind one to another.
Mm-hmm.
Tenderhearted, forgiving one another.
Free.
Even as God, for Christ's sake,
let me say this about unforgiveness and sin. God sees that the same as he sees cheat as cheating. If I cheat on my wife and she does not forgive me, God sees us in the same boat. I'm going to say that one more time. If I cheat on my wife and she does not forgive me, she is just as wrong in God's eyes as I am. Let me put some Bible on. Matthew 6 and 14. Right. Hold on. I have not cheated on my wife. All right. Amen. She need to know. I know you know. I ain't going home with you though. Amen. All of her life, I cheated on you. Amen. Verse 14.
Lord, you forgive me of your trespasses. Your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you forgive not me of their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses.
Here's what I'm saying. We got to get to a point where we stop confessing each other's sins. See, the anger that I have, the frustration that I have is holding me back. So I got to get on my knees and pray to God, take that anger away from me. I'm not worried about him. I'm not worried about her. Lord, I am angry. And I got all this stuff that I'm dealing with. they do. It says, while we were yet enemies, he reconciled us to God by the death of his son. Turn, if you would, to Ephesians 2 and 14. I'm almost closing. Almost. We getting close. Amen. We getting close.
I tell you,
and the lesson is yours. But some relationships are so bad that it's easier to just avoid. But he needed help. And after the angel stretches him, you know what happened? Here comes Judas. Y'all know who Judas is? Judas was in his inner circle. Judas was one of his homeboys. Judas was one that he broke bread with. Judas was the one that he gave power to heal folks. He blessed Judas. And here comes Judas with a whole posse of folk that are about to arrest him and put him on the cross. Somebody will ask me, why did Jesus not smoke this man when he saw him coming? And then Judas had the nerve to kiss him. I'm telling you, if I would have been Jesus, I would have smoked all. Oh, it would have been some fine gravestone. I would have smoked all of them. But why did he smoke them? He didn't smoke them because he was there to become what? Come on now, church. He was there to become peace. And then you look at Peter. Peter said, Lord, I'll go with you unto the end of the earth. Peter denies him three times. Come on now. Now, if he was healing Peter's mama, he knew who Jesus was. When he let Peter catch all those fish and get rich off of him, he knew who Peter was. But now, when Jesus is by himself and they beating on him and they spitting on him, now he don't even know the man. I'd have smoked Peter too. Somebody ought to ask me, why did we smoke Peter? Because he was there to become what? He was there to become peace. Then the Bible says that they accused him, but he didn't even open his mouth. He didn't open his mouth. There's some things in your relationship that you want to say. There are some justifications of why you feel like you feel, why you are where you are, and you want to get them off of your chest. The Bible said Jesus, he didn't even open his mouth. I would have smoked Pilate. I would have smoked all of them. But he became peace. Sometimes we say, I'm the only one praying. They got to meet me halfway. I'm the only one trying. They got to meet me halfway. You know what forgiveness means? It means literally to untie, to release the other person. In other words, you're not waiting for the other person to acknowledge that they're wrong. You're not waiting before they take the first step and show that they deserve to be forgiven. It means to release who? Yourself. That's what Jesus did. He's on the cross and he says, Father, forgive them. If you want intimacy with God, learn to pray. And this is something that he wants us to experience with him. The reason my wife and I are close is because we share a whole lot of things.
Well,
we share a house. When we first married, we shared a car. We shared kids. We share kids, amen. A bank account. Jesus wants us to share this with him. That's how you get intimate with God. By forgiving others the way that he has forgiven us. And I'm telling you, our churches will be better. Our relationships will be better. The reason the murder rate is what it is in Chicago, 600 murders, is because we are not preaching forgiveness. We got to learn to be the children of God. I pray. You've heard the word. Believe it with all of your heart. Repent of your sins. Confess Christ to be the Son of the living God. And when we go down in the watery grave of baptism, for the remission of your sins, that puts you into Christ. For the next 30 days, pray this prayer. Pray the prayer of forgiveness. And here's what it is, the prayer of reconciliation. Say, Lord, give me the strength to love my enemies, to bless them that curse me, to do good to them that hate me. Help me to pray for those who despitefully use me and persecute me, that I may be the child of God. Come to Jesus as together we stand.